another evening, this Tammy Esting. You may remember her presentation she did for us in Montessori Europe. And we so loved the presentation that we have invited her back to share her wisdom about employing staff and helping to train people and helping the Montessori community to grow in their wisdom and in their training. So I think the best thing is to hand it over to Tammy, give her a presentation, and we will have time for questions and answers at the end. Or you can put some questions in the chat if you feel more comfortable with that. It's wonderful to see faces that we have worked with for many, many months, but it's also lovely to welcome one or two new people and new names. I hope you will enjoy Tammy's presentation, and we are delighted to have you with us tonight. Over to you, Tammy.
Thank you so much, Barbara and Wendelin as well. Thank you so much for bringing me back again. I love chatting with the Montessori Musings community and beyond. Tonight, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen so I'm not just looking at me. Here we go. So I'm delighted to be chatting with you all today about something that I'm a little bit passionate about. Okay, I'm a lot passionate about the transformation, or what I'm calling the evolution of the Montessori guide. And in my deep dive into the inner workings of my own personal evolution in relation to the conditions that have amplified or muted my path, I've discovered a few insights that I'd like to share with you about noticeable patterns of growth for adults in Montessori. So it's my hope that you will recognize yourself in some of these patterns and that you will see your potential and possibly adopt some strategies to promote collective growth within your community. So in this next half hour, I plan to highlight a few concepts that I've gleaned from the quantum universe, such as a framework of what's called holonic structures, and I'm going to swing back to that, as well as chaos theory and the meta process of adaptation called structural coupling that will help us better understand, I hope, this development of the Montessori guide. My hope is that you will also walk away with an awareness of the systems and transitions inherent in your growth and in relation to your colleagues and beyond. So before we dig into the content, I would like to propose that we take a quick 30 seconds to reflect on your own personal evolution. So just take a moment and think, how are you different today than you were when you first stepped foot in your first Montessori environment? So just reflect on that. I know I didn't give you much time. I've had a lot more time to think about this too. And I have to tell you that one of the primary ways that I am radically different than I was 28 years ago when I first stepped into my first Montessori environment is, and which has a bearing on this conversation, is that I've adopted what I would say is a cosmic lens in which I view everything. And from the discovery of the child, Dr. Montessori expanded my understanding of self as is entwined with the universe when she wrote, "We are created in order to evolve the cosmos." So that idea has been lurking in my very being. Yeah, all the parts came together for me in one idea that we are inherently part of the cosmos and we have a responsibility to it, what Montessori called our cosmic task. And our personal evolution changes the universe. So this understanding forms the foundation for exploring the evolution of the Montessori guide, one who is co-creating those conditions to expand consciousness, and in which this co-creation requires adaptation and ultimately evolution. So just a year later, Dr. Montessori wrote in The Formation of Man, if the whole universe is governed by fixed laws, is it possible that the human mind can be formed haphazardly, i.e. without any law at all? Everything in the course of development passes through a complex process of evolution. So the idea that we develop based on an evolutionary process outlined by the patterns or laws of the universe motivated me to understand how it is that we construct ourselves in relation to all that surrounds us. And of course, it's a short step or leap to take a look at the conditions that surround the child as well. So what better place, I think, to look at that than to start with the good doctor's revelations about development as expressed in her planes of development theory. So as you are likely highly familiar with, Dr. Montessori fashioned the initial four planes of development through the lens of constructivism, the theory that humans acquire or construct cognition in relation to what they already know. Expanding on Montessori's stages of development in those first 24 years of life, my mentor and friend of the Montessori family, Dr. Philip Snow-Gang, has shared a supposition of adult development that supports current andragogy and neuroscience, what he calls the fifth plane of development, in which there's a birth of our great work or cosmic task is often revealed. So I'm really intrigued by the innate drive that is early development, the genetic and environmental conditions that characterize this transition from one plane to another. And I wonder if I might better understand adult development if I take each of these planes and nest it one into the next, which is called a holonic structure. So if I think about this, just reimagining each plane of development in a more nested system, a holonic structure, that it helps me understand the or highlights the dynamism between the planes of development that might lend some insight into constructivism. So, and I propose that the great work or cosmic task of the adult follows a similar pattern of construction and consolidation, an ebb and flow throughout the lifespan, and characterized by this clear transitional period throughout our lives. Which leads me to my next discovery on this journey regarding planes of development and adult development and how it is embedded in the theories of constructivism. So now we're looking at the adult learner here. And I'm gonna go ahead and lean on an emerging branch of science called radical neuroconstructivism. It's really just a fancy way of talking about this unification of the biological, the psychological, and an educational framework for viewing brain and cognitive development. And it's a legacy of constructivism, and it lends more insight into human potentiality and the work of optimizing adult education. Mind, brain, and education science professor, researcher and author Tracy Tokohama Espinosa wrote The Five Pillars of the Mind, just released in 2019. This is really fresh work. And she revealed how radical neuroconstructivism focuses on development on a cellular level, including how our neuronal networks provide insights into human growth, which is about how we're changing, And in this adult body, I see that I'm still changing. And also development, or the structural change called ontology. So radical neuroconstructivists concur that ontogenesis, which is really meaning it's Greek for being and birth, is the development of an organism. It's a function of molecular, cellular, bodily, social events, or gene to gene, gene to environment interactions. Yet my research has concluded that current neuroconstructivist research supports and expands upon theories of development by Montessori and her constructivist peers, such as Jean Piaget, Alfred Adler, Lev Vygotsky, Eric Erickson, and Rudolf Dreikers. And you might be wondering, how does this relate to us, to our growth? Well, radical neuroconstructivism is relational. The interactions between entities that promote change and the potentiality of humans to change. Now, I recently concluded a big research project regarding mechanisms for transformation in adult education, and included an engagement exercise with my research participants using a short article printed in NAMTA's Whole School Montessori Handbook and written by Sharon Double, titled Stages of Teacher Development. This is what I presented for Montessori Europe not so long ago. So you're going to get a little refresher here, and then we're going to expand upon that as well, in case you didn't get to see that. So what I'm about to share with you about Double's work is based on the work of andragogy, which really just means the art and science of teaching adults. And that is founded by Malcolm and Huldah Knowles. My intention for including this in my research, and one of the reasons I'm highlighting this here, is in the hope that recognition of these stages of development will create more agency for adults in Montessori in pursuing their cosmic task. So, back to my research. As a whole group with my research participants, I offered this metaphor of the journey of a Montessori guide in three components of a tree. The foundation is the root system, representing initial Montessori training, because we have to start somewhere. And the trunk of the tree represents the growth of the guide. And the branches and the leaves and the fruit of the tree represent the potential impact and reciprocity to nourish the whole. So participants were invited to name for themselves what came before their Montessori training that builds their core self, their heartwood that's resistant to change. And the learning community agreed that innate characteristics, things they're born with, that's the gene-to-gene interaction, their family and their educational experiences, cultural conditioning, life experiences, and even their self-concept as a learner form the sense of self and leave metaphorical growth rings. So discussions in the group started with really generalized characteristics of each stage of development, their attributable needs, and the possible areas of support. So here's where it gets interesting. Double calls the first stage of training to be a Montessori guide the neonate stage, which is characterized by an idealistic approach to Montessori, a fascination towards application, and a sense of vulnerability. She identified two primary needs of the neonate guide, of needing freedom to practice without feeling abandoned. And they need ongoing orientation to school and culture, and sometimes Montessori. And then the support strategies for the neonate guide are to protect them from all that of that feeling of being so overwhelmed, providing regular hands-on support and that regular dialogue that's necessary for them to craft their practice, their implementation. So this is also a great stage to build a network of other same level guides. So the next stage of development, the double identified, is consolidation. And it's characterized by a focus on the classroom, self-motivation and direction, and an exhibition of self-confidence and joy. So this can last anywhere from 2 to 5 years, typically, and generally begins during a practicum period of training. The guide needs, in this stage of their development, attention, in part because it's easy to overlook the guide that is joyfully self-directed and motivated, and they need stability and discrete and direct input into their practices. The type of support that Double suggested for this stage includes continued education in Montessori, observing others at the same level, and creating conditions for collaborative dialogue about expectations and goals. And I know I'm flying right along here, but this is a little bit of a review for many of you. The third stage of development of the Montessori guide, according to Double, is that of renewal, which becomes evident somewhere between the 7th and the 10th year of training. Like stages of development, it can be at different times for different people based on those conditions. This may be the most critical point in our evolution as guides, as it reveals the common characteristics of guides questioning their effectiveness and that of the method, behaving as if they are on automatic pilot, a clear lack of enthusiasm, and guides at this stage may be argumentative. This felt very familiar to me, by the way. Their needs are to understand the larger context of their work. They need to explore their career options and to invest in further study. Double suggests offering a guide at this renewal stage, opportunities for leadership in the community, arranging outside of the community networking opportunities, and for the guide to observe across the continuum. Finally, the fourth stage of development of the Montessori guide, as proposed by Double, is that of the seasoned guide, who are characteristically open to ideas, questions, and critiques. They're internally motivated and they have deep critical thinking skills. And their decision-making centers key principles and values. So the seasoned guide needs opportunity for outreach and creativity. Double suggests providing support by offering opportunities for greater leadership and, interestingly, for sabbatical, that critical liminal space necessary for transitions to blossom. So this exercise really offered peered teaching and structured learning, created a self-identified placement and dialogue about where each of my research participants saw themselves on their trajectory of teacher development. And participants reported seeing themselves in all four stages that further connected their feelings, their connection with each other, both in the moment, and it set the stage for further support, that empathy for another, for their colleague, as well as just that connectivity. At the end of the workshop, the impact of this work was referenced as super powerful, and that the guides saw themselves as part of that continuum of learning. And when shared with their colleagues, they reported a sense of valuing each other more based on both the nuances, little sip. I'm in the Colorado Rockies and it's really dry here. So they reported this sense of valuing each other better and each other more based on those nuances of identifiable growth rings and where they were in their trajectory. Pardon me. So, if there are identifiable stages of development for children, what might be driving transitions between planes of adult development? What is the catalyst for these transformations? This is where I've been living for a while, right? So again, I turned to Dr. Montessori, who saw her methodology as an aid to life. And the concept of an education centered around the care of the living being alters all previous ideas, resting no longer on a curriculum or a timetable. Education must conform to the facts of human life. And one of the primary facts of human life is that change is inevitable, and it is the stuff of transformation. Change is different from transitions. Change is situational. Transitions are psychological. They are a reorientation and a self-redefinition that you go through in order to incorporate any of those changes into your life. Change can lead to transition, and transitions can lead to change. Changes are also driven by a goal. And transitions start with letting go of what no longer fits or is adequate to the life stage that you're in. So there's a clear pattern to all transitions. We have three phases. An ending is what happens first. That recognizing, the recognition that this is not no longer working for me. Think about that guide in the renewal stage and their need for recognizing this. Then there's this neutral zone or liminal space that occurs, or that we have to intentionally make space for the new beginning to arise. From one of my favorite books about transitions, I love this quote, "I find daily reminders that the true essence of life lies in transition, where hope and creativity, insight and possibility reside. Transition is at the heart of revitalization and transformation. Renewal occurs when we relinquish something we were attached to and follow life's invitation toward a new energy and a fresh purpose." So let's take a closer look at the mechanisms behind transformation and what wisdom the universe has to offer. So understanding transformation is accompanied by a deep dive into the characteristics of chaos and order as a generating force, and I suspect is crucial to truly comprehend the story of our journey. The scientific term chaos refers to an underlying interconnectedness that exists in apparently random events. Chaos science focuses on hidden patterns, nuance, or the sensitivity of things and the rules for how the unpredictable leads to the new. So the theory relies on the discovery of dissipative structures by the 1977 Nobel Peace Prize winner in chemistry, Ilya Prigogine. And essentially, Prigogine's focus on the paradox of structures that dissipate energy or let go of their energy in order for new, more complex ones to emerge, encapsulates what's called a structural coupling. It just means that this interplay between that is relational changes us. And in adult learning environments where revolutionary ideas for education disrupt homeostasis, the status quo, the knowledge of this idea may play an important role in cultivating a feedback loop of understanding. Could our understanding of how we have to let go of what's not working in order to make way for the new is part of our transformational patterns. So just think of that neonate guide's commitment to Montessori may also precipitate a unique need to unlearn specific conditioning. That will pave the way for a paradigm shift. So chaos theory gives me a better framework in which to don this new lens, and in which I see the patterns, the delusions, the metaphors of my life, and helps me question my assumptions and opinions of reality by reformation of this system, my own system. Chaos theory teaches that when our psychological perspective shifts through moments of amplification and bifurcation, our degrees of freedom expand and we experience being and truth. We are then creative and our true self lies there. So think of chaos as a form of rebirth. And as Dr. Montessori wrote in The Absorbent Mind, development is a series of rebirths. So expanding upon, or maybe even mirroring the tendency of the universe is what I suspect is a human tendency towards orienting ourselves in the universe as seen through our mythologies or our culturally contextual narratives. We have a lot of these in Montessori. And I look to the work of cultural historian Thomas Berry, who writes about acquiring a grateful and cosmic reciprocity, as illustrated through four symbols or archetypes that establish humans as a viable species in a viable life system. And I would expand on that to think about ourselves as viably responsive practitioners. And as a teacher educator, that's my aim. Right? So these four archetypes are pretty clear. And I'm sharing this in part because I'm hoping that you see this in your patterns as well. The first is to embrace our archetypical journey of the universe that is reflected in our own experiences, to see ourselves as entwined with the universe. The second is to gain our archetypical sense of the creative forces of the universe through the symbol of the Great Mother. The third is to recognize the organic unity and reality of the universe through the symbols of the cosmic tree or tree of life. And the fourth one is to adopt the sense of systemic processes in the continuous transformation in the symbol of death and rebirth. This is a guiding force for this study. This fourth archetypical symbol of death and rebirth denotes transformation, and human development might be viewed as a series of deaths and rebirths. So before I wrap up here, I just wanted to emphasize that these growth rings, the metaphorical growth rings, are a suggested trajectory of patterns. And evolution relies on what is called structural coupling, or that emergent co-creation between entities. We don't evolve in a vacuum. We adapt to our conditions. And as we develop, we impact those conditions that further impact us. So in just a moment, I'm going to close the deck and invite you to engage in this content with each other, creating the conditions by which you're evolving. And my guiding question to launch the discussion, and I'll put it in, and that went too quickly, but here it is. It's how might knowledge of stages of developmental tendencies and the mechanisms of transformation impact our growth? Consider how it might impact adult agency, lifelong learning, increase efficacy in the classrooms with families, or even as practical as reduce attrition. So you can find me in many places, including my professional development places, Classroom Mechanics Principles to Practice, where I offer live and virtual learning opportunities for adult learners. In closing, thank you. And I'm going to stop the share.
Thank you so much, Tammy. Fascinating. So much for the brain. I think we will have to revisit your circles over and over before we fully understand the adaptation we all need to take in order to face the adaptation that is required and the transformation. But I have lost the question. How might knowledge of stages of developmental tendencies and the mechanisms of transformation impact our growth? Oh, that's your question. So sorry.
That's my growth. That's my question, my leading question that I thought might help us in exploring this. This is a big idea. And I gave you a couple of structural pieces to understand some of the transformation, but it's very surface because transformation is very complex, is what I've learned. There are many conditions.
But if you're providing a framework for these like adult learners, and letting them know it's going to be hard and you're going to keep going through these stages just so that they don't give up when it gets hard or they get stuck, and just to encourage them to just keep trying, and heck me, to keep growing and trying. And every now and then it's like, oh, maybe I'm consolidating things right now, but I love the framework and expanding beyond just the four planes.
Thank you for that, Laura, and it's so nice to see you. And I agree that knowledge of this framework helped me understand, I see myself in this plane, and maybe it's that metacognition that is a powerful tool for transformation. And this idea that if we can see ourselves and we see that there is some identifiable characteristics, it almost lets me breathe a little easier to know that if I'm in this, you know, stage where I need renewal, that I'm not alone. It's recognizable. And that the people around me, if they know it too, that there might be some conditions that we can create to support me in this transition. Yeah. Aaron, can you close the door? Other thoughts people might have? Suzanne, hi, nice to see you.
Hi, Tammy. Thanks for that. That was amazing. My voice is a little bit croaky, but I was struggling to write fast enough with what you were saying. Just one thing that really sort of stuck with me now was, you know, what you spoke about transition and change. Mm-hmm. And I think for some reason, I just really got focused on that part, because I thought, you know, so often we don't allow ourselves to transition because we're frightened of change. Mm-hmm. But if we're going to look at progressing through those different, the stages or the growth rings of being a practitioner or whatever it is that we are, I really think that we somehow need to cultivate in ourselves, in our students, in the children, a much more positive attitude to mistakes, or, you know, to what is seen as mistakes, and to not look at everything as a failure and I failed at this, so I need to stop, but to look at it as this opportunity for change, and that that requires a transition in the way that we have viewed things, the way that we view ourselves, and the way that we view what is to come in the future, because I think that's the only way that we really can progress through the rings.
I love that you said that, Suzanne. Vanderbilt University has identified a part of our brain they've dubbed the OOPS Center. And it is where the deep learning occurs, that we don't learn super well unless we make the mistakes. That's a complete shift from what I was raised with, right? That, and that growth mindset of saying, I haven't figured it out yet, to become part of our culture, the climate. But I think that we need to look at that for adult learners as well. That adult learners struggle, in my observations, in multiple arenas, we struggle with perfectionism, of doing it right and getting it right. And oftentimes adults are struggling as well with any level of ambiguity, that the ambiguity of our lives, I mean, look at the pandemic. The ambiguity of the pandemic was really jarring for most people, to the point of, and it just froze them in place. The most profound times of my life that I have found transformation is when I have gifted myself the time and the space, that liminal space, for something new to emerge, for the consolidation of what came before and the letting go of the things that didn't work in order to look forward. And I think about our practicums. Are our practicums long enough for adult learners? Are they scaffolded enough? Do we bring in enough information about the neuroscience behind learning and the OOPS Center and a growth mindset? I don't know, but I know that those are all bundled in this whole nuanced question. And I know I want to hear from you too, but I have one more piece to this, and that is that disequilibrium, that is a great place to be. And most people are fighting for equilibrium, but that's where the dissipative structures help us, is that if I have knowledge that I actually do have to let go, that disequilibrium may be the point more than equilibrium, that is where the learning happens, that I might be able to lean further into that discomfort I might feel. I'm nomadic, so I'm pretty okay with ambiguity, but most people in my life are not. And it takes a lot of practice.
But that's where your chaos theory is such a useful tool. And this is, if you refer it to practicum, and if you think about the curve of work, the moments when the chaos occurs, this is where the practitioner panics instead of letting it emerge into new energy. I mean, Montessori was so clever in understanding that when there is that disequilibrium of the group, by standing back, more often than not, the transformation occurs and we get the rebirth of the child in that moment. And also, if we understand, or if we engage with the chaos theory a little bit more, we will give the child the opportunity to show us the way, because it's the chaos theory which holds us, wants us to control the situation, and makes us not feel comfortable.
Absolutely. Suzanne.
Sorry, I feel like I'm hogging the platform, but I had another thought. I was also thinking, when you were asking about the length of the practicum, something that's been on my mind since I did my master's research, in terms of looking at, you know, whether Montessori practice is being is being practiced the way that we teach it, was mm-hmm. also something along the lines of not just so much our practicum in terms of, you know, before you now get your piece of paper that says you're a teacher. Because once you've got your piece of paper that says you're a teacher, you're kind of now left out, you know, in the big pond. Mm-hmm. And I'm also thinking, you know, when you're looking at moving through the growth rings, you also need experience. You need a shift of mindset. So you're not just theory, but you've now, you had the practice and you realize that those sweet little nunus are not so sweet the way Montessori says they're going to be, you know, because they say no, and they do things that they shouldn't be doing. And I actually wonder, instead of having a longer practicum, whether there shouldn't be, and I don't have the answer, something that for a period of years, you know, that people need to come back and they need to revisit. And in that revisiting, gain the growth, because they need to be on a different, they need to have an expanded mindset to be able to take in the new information, you know, have had more disequilibrium to, right. yeah, to create from there.
I'm in full agreement. I believe that, you know, I'm part of my passion is lifelong learning. And how do we cultivate that in our adult learners? My research, the focus is really about awe and wonder and the impact of this affective state on the adult learner, and how in Montessori we might be able to harness events that promote awe and wonder to recreate the human, to be have a disposition toward awe, to become that lifelong learner, to seek out and have agency. And I think you pegged, it's not necessarily the length of the of that mentor, that apprenticeship, although I think it would help to have closer apprenticeship structures in our teacher training. But I do think that it's the lifelong learning, because we're not the same. Experience is, you know, a critical part. I wasn't the same teacher 5 years in that I was 10 years in than I am today. That it's different. I've observed in Montessori classrooms where teachers are going from the lesson plan and they're doing it exactly, rather than understanding the patterns of learning to be able to respond to the child. But most Montessori teacher education programs, and I'm going out on a limb here, but what I have observed, do not actually teach the way we ask our teachers to teach. We are not modeling Montessori methodology in teacher education. And that alone, I think, is a hiccup. And when we don't understand the transformation, I know I went through these series of transformations in my training. My first training as a 3-6 guide, I was blown away. My life was forever changed. Happened again when I did my elementary training. Happened again when I just didn't finish my master's, right? This is these moments, but we don't talk about transformation very much. What is driving the transformation? How do we continue this path? So the evolution of a Montessori guide, really, I was so thrilled that Barbara and Wendelin asked, can you talk about this? And it's like, I get to like live in this space for a little bit and explore it. And I don't have the answers, but I have a lot more questions. Any other thoughts people might have about how this metacognizance of these tendencies or mechanisms might impact growth of the adult learner or yourself? Threw out a lot of different ideas. I went out on another limb and changed Dr. Montessori's planes of development. You might have noticed that. I know that's a lot of hubris on my end, but I'm playing around with the idea. And in part because I could see how critical, when you nest the planes, it's, it, for some reason, it felt less linear well, it is less linear, but it felt more relational to me. How do each of these planes, is there's this moment of emergence of something new that's happening in this new plane? We know children's development is driven through their gene to gene and gene to environment interactions, but so are we as adults. So what is that space? What are the mechanisms?
It's such a positive lens to look through, Tammy, because there's hope even for oldies like me. There's still an opportunity for transformation, opportunity to learn something new. And I was reading a chapter in the 1913 Rome lectures about on attention, and suddenly I learned something which gave all the background to the sensorial materials. And I thought, that's where she has come from. And it then gives me totally different view of the sensorial materials. So there's a tiny little opportunity for transformation virtually every single day. But it just depends on how ready we are to take it in, because sometimes we are just overwhelmed by situation. Giving yourself the space to contemplate, giving the space to process, giving the, and not be afraid of the change this may cause us, it's all very, very important. And we never ever talk about the philosophical element of being a human teacher. Particularly, we talk about the technical aspects of being a teacher, and that actually could hold you back, because you could become very fossilized in the moment and never evolve beyond the initial teacher training. And I think that's where much of the Montessori community needs to really look at, because then in the second stage, where people get some experience and have a little bit more confidence, they also wear themselves out and leave the profession because they don't have enough to feed them in order to make that transformation towards the next, or have the reverse towards the next stage. So yes, so much to think about.
I think about those feedback loops within learning communities. Do we have, you know, and maybe that's a big part of it. How do we identify for ourselves when, what are those mechanisms that are helping me transcend the mechanical application? I'm wanting to transcend that so that I can grow. And as an adult learner in a Montessori community, I get really caught up with the day-to-day stuff, not recognizing that stagnation you're talking about. Would you call it fossilizing? I love it. Fossilification.
I did some work out in Malawi, and it was really interesting as a teacher trainer to go out with a very westernized approach. And the biggest barrier we had was the language. So we couldn't use such traditional forms and teaching. And over that 3-year period, I developed a huge amount as a teacher trainer, because we had to use what I call the very Montessori way of teaching the adults, for them to learn about the Montessori environment, about who they were. So telling them what a Montessori teacher is in their cultural context, and with the tools that they had, which wasn't very many, how they could find that Montessori from inside themselves to support the children in understanding the concepts, because we didn't always have the equipment either. So that was a really amazing journey to do, something we're still doing with them now, and about them now sharing their knowledge on to the next set of teachers that they're working with. So that was a really interesting journey for me, to take a very different approach, and that in turn has enabled me to we've really developed our training program to bring in those real experiences rather than the abstract experiences. So that was great for me to develop myself, and then to develop our students in the follow-up.
I love that, Michelle. Thank you for sharing that. I think about this all the time. I think about how, if our cosmic task is to see the reciprocity, our giving of our deep gratitude and love for the universe and all mm-hmm. things. And the outcome is interconnectivity, or the sense of interconnectivity and interdependence of all things. And the idea is that we are positioning children to grow naturally in these environments, that they too have this deep sense of reciprocity and gratitude and interconnectivity and interdependence. But how do we do that? By compartmentalizing either how we're teaching them or how we're teaching the adults. How do the teachers get it? How are the educators themselves acquiring that sensibility if, as teacher educators, we're compartmentalizing all the parts? So it's really shifting me. And I see you, Suzanne, you're next. It's really shifting me in the field to think about how is it that I am pulling back from lectures and creating deeper dialogue so that adults can really play and explore with the ideas and increase simulations so that they have the interconnected movement in the environments so that they can see how this is not a methodology that is compartmentalized. It is entwined, so that they then will be moving that into communities around. Suzanne.
Tammy, I was also just thinking, when you nested the planes of development, it was amazing how just that change in the visual all of a sudden just reshifts your brain cells. Because as I looked at that nesting, I was also thinking immediately of, let's just say, personality development, you know, where you're starting with the child at the core and then seeing how, obviously, you know, you could add ecological systems to that, but how, you know, influences change. So you could put into that core of the planes of development, you could put Erikson's psychosocial development theory, you can put Bowlby's attachment, for example, and that internal working model of the child right at the center. And I think you said that somewhere, that you had your innate characteristics at the center and that you then build out from there. And it was just amazing how just changing that, as it were, currently that compartmentalized, here's the planes of development, first, second, third, fourth, or now fifth, when you just change the perspective of it, it automatically kind of allows your brain a little bit more freedom to think about it in a different way.
I love it that you said that. I'm a big fan of these visualizations. I spend a lot of time, my background is as an artist, so I have a degree in metal sculpture. But the idea here that we are with those holonic structures, the nested structures, it's about the interaction between the planes that I wanted to see. I wanted to see, how am I thinking about the mechanisms that move us from one plane to the next? And less so in the first four planes in the 24 years of life, but more so, what happens in our planes of development as adults? What is that emergent quality that helps us transcend what came before and who we were before? And that, I think, it's mind blowing. I'm so pleased that you're getting it, because I take it from my brain and wonder, oh my gosh, they're going to think I'm crazy beans here. But big ideas.
But it was the nested circles, when you presented them for the first time, that have urged us to invite you again, because they were so beautiful and there was so much more to understand about them. And of course, there continues to be so much more to understand. Yeah. But the beauty of it, also the softness of the color and the permeation of the one color into another, makes it all much, much softer, much more acceptable, much more relating to how life is, rather than those pointed triangles, which seem to turn end in a point as if it was finite and a pinnacle of achievement, and then you somehow lose it again to reach the next achievement. Life is not like that. As Laura says, it's much more organic.
Mm-hmm. I agree. I'm very attracted to circles. I think that, again, it's something that we, as humans, we have a tendency towards circles in many ways as a way of connecting ideas and connecting all the parts. And then the idea of the nesting circles creates more tension, and it is more infinite. I totally agree, Barbara. What a great way to put it.
It also has a connection with Brunner's spiral. So it grows. Yes. And it has got that flexibility to sometimes squash and sometimes bounce up.
Absolutely. It's all in relation. It's one of my takeaways.
I hope those of you who have remained silent are still feeling that there is much for you to think about, as those of us who have spoken feel, I think. And if you have further thoughts, please email them to us or put them, you know, reflect on Tammy's inspiration, which we posted on Montessori Europe website on the weekend, because this is an opportunity for all of us to grow, and each one will grow in a different way, but together we will grow a little bit wiser, a little bit more flexible, so that we can serve the children just a little bit better. Thank you, everybody. And thank you so much, Tammy. Beautiful.
Thank you. Beautiful. Thank you so much, Barbara. And you too, Wendell. And thank you, everybody, for being here.